the name of Jesus Christ, welcome now to this time of prayer at Central United Methodist Church. We gather every Thursday midday to pray for the needs of our church and our community and our world. We normally celebrate the sacrament of Holy Communion together, and if you've not participated in one of these services, once we're able to worship together in person, I would invite you to come join us at one of those. But we do today gather in prayer and in worship as we pray for our church, our community, and our world. And I'm grateful that you've chosen to be with us today on Facebook Live. And please continue to monitor Central's social media accounts so that you can see other ways that you can continue to participate in our church life together. Please follow us on Facebook, find our YouTube page, check in on our website. At our resource pages there, as we continue to go through this unusual time together. But as we gather now, I would invite you to hear this greeting. Are any among you sick? They should call for the elders of the church and have them pray over them, anointing them with oil in the name of the Lord. The prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise them up, and anyone who has committed sins will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you may be healed. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, who can banish all affliction, both of soul and of body, show forth your power upon those in need, that by your mercy they may be restored to serve you afresh in holiness of living, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our scripture reading this morning is from Paul's letter to the Romans, the 8th chapter, verses 37 through 39. Hear now the word of God. Know, in all these things you are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. These words have been with me for a couple of weeks now. I find comfort in these words that tell us that God loves us. That God loves us, that nothing can change God's love for us, that nothing can remove God's love for us, that no matter what happens in the world, nothing can separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ. Those are powerful words for me to think about, and I hope all of us to keep in our hearts as we journey forward into these unusual times together. Derek said last week at this service, and I want to reiterate it again and let you hear the same words from me, that this COVID-19 virus is not from God. God is not punishing us for something. God is not trying to use a radical way to make us change course. God is not causing something awful and deadly to happen so to teach us some lesson or so that we might change course, although it may cause us to change course and we may learn a lesson from it. God is not the cause. We live in a fallen world. And because we live in a fallen world, awful things happen. But I believe that those awful things are not from God. Our loving God doesn't cause bad things to happen, but when bad things do happen, he loves us through them. I don't think it's a coincidence that when Jesus speaks of his relationship to God and our relationship to God, he uses language of parenthood. He speaks of God as a loving father and reminds us that that same loving heavenly parent loves us and loves us no matter what we're going through. As I say, he's not the cause of what we're going through, but God can love us through whatever we're going through. As I was thinking about this idea, two things came to mind for me. When I was 6 years old, I was diagnosed with pneumonia. I was very sick. My parents didn't know what to do with me. I was the oldest child, so those of you who have children know that the oldest child is the one the parents learn everything on. So my parents did what you did, and I knew it was serious because both of them went with me to the pediatrician's office while my grandmother kept my little brother at home. And my pediatrician took a look at me and said, he needs to go to a pulmonologist right now. My pediatrician's office was in one of those big medical parks where there's doctor's offices and a couple of buildings. And so I remember it was a rainy day, it was a cold day, and I remember feeling the worst maybe I've ever felt. You don't remember those things clearly, but I remember that I was miserable. But the other thing I remember is my father carrying me the whole length from the pediatrician's office out of that building, into another building, and down another hall, into a pulmonologist's office, a man who would be my doctor for the next several years, in fact. But I remember my father carrying me. I probably could have walked if I was forced to, but he carried me because his child was sick. His child felt miserable. His child was scared. His child didn't understand what was going on, but he knew it was serious. And so my father carried me. I think some years later, when I was 16 and found myself in the hospital on the other side of some fairly serious surgery, I won't go into the long and short of it. Let's just say I wasn't put together with the altogether well. If there were a warranty on a human being, they would have used mine. But I had to have some surgery to correct the circulatory disorder. And we discovered it when I had something that a sort of healthcare event happened that, if the surgery hadn't gone well, would have meant that my right hand would be dead. I'd probably have it, but I wouldn't be able to move it. And when I was 16, I was able to understand medically what was going on, but I had the confidence of a 16-year-old that it'll probably work out. Nothing's going to happen to me. I'll be okay. And I think of that time in my life, 10 days in the hospital post-surgery, and my mother, who never left. My mother, who I heard crying when she thought I was asleep. My mother, who couldn't do anything to make me better, who had to trust those entrusted, those doctors and nurses and all those who were taking care of me. She had to trust them to do everything. But she was with me, and she loved me through those days. Friends, as I say, it's no coincidence. God uses parent language and symbolism to describe our relationship to God. God carries us when we're too weak to walk. God loves us through whatever we're going through when we don't know how or even understand what's going on. I think as a society, as a community, as a state, as a nation, as a world, that's what we're going through right now. We don't understand what's happening. We don't know what we can do about it, but we can be confident that God loves us. These words from Romans say nothing can separate us from the love of God. God loves us. God will carry us when we're too weak to walk, and God will love us through whatever comes. And you may look around and say, Thomas, I don't see it. Well, let me tell you where you can see it. Do you need evidence of God's love? I read a blog article recently from Tom Rapsis's blog, Wake Up Call, where he reminds us of Mr. Rogers. Y'all remember Mr. Rogers, Fred Rogers? You might not know about Fred Rogers, and in addition to shaping the childhood of at least a generation and a half, He was an ordained Presbyterian minister. And so when you hear Fred Rogers saying something, remember, he's not just saying it as somebody who's being a presenter on a children's TV program. He's also speaking as someone who's sorting through things with an eye on God. Fred Rogers has, to paraphrase a quote in one of his shows, he talks about when he was a boy and he saw things that were frightening and that he didn't understand, and his mother said to him, "Look for the helpers. You will always find people who are helping." Friends, I think that's, in this crisis in which we find ourselves, I think that is one of the places we can and will see the love of God made real, in the helpers. Look for the helpers. Look for nurses. Look for doctors. Look for healthcare workers of every rank working to help people. But friends, there are other helpers too. Think about the people working in the grocery store. You're frustrated because you can't find the things you need, yet they're there. Think about the people working in the pharmacies, making sure that we have the things we need to keep us healthy. Think about just yesterday, sitting in my office, I heard a fire truck go down Jevis Street. And I'm thinking, there's a helper. There are a group of people going to help someone in need. Think about our first responders who are still showing up every day. Friends, look to the helpers, and we will see evidence of God's love. Look to the helpers, and we can be convinced and reminded anew that God is with us, that God loves us through whatever we go through, and that God can carry us through whatever we need. Look for the helpers, and you'll see evidence that God is with us. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.
So as we gather virtually to pray together with one another, I want to say I really appreciate those of you who have contacted us and shared your concerns and your worries, even your joys during this past week. We've added to the prayer cards that we maintain and prayed over them. And I want you to know that we hear you and we're praying with you and for you. And now as we pray together, please join me. Almighty God, we gather today from various places in the world to worship you, to be in spiritual communion with one another, and most especially to bring our joys and burdens to you. Because of your great love for us, we feel the confidence to lift up our prayers for ourselves and for others. We continue to ask for courage to face this challenge, as well as the many other challenges in this world. Help us also to look inward and consider personally what we are doing as your disciples, how we are following Christ by loving you and our neighbors. Guide us. Father God, we know that you understand our suffering, and we lift those up who are named and those who remain unnamed, but on our hearts, to your care. Please continue to provide comfort to the family of Lenora Salibi and Juanita Skinner. Please comfort the Leek family in the loss of Hank's brother Hollis. Comfort the Rawl and Eldridge family as they grieve the loss of Nancy's sister. Comfort, Lord, and provide peace to all who are grieving, as we know that the pain of missing loved ones is a long struggle. Lord, we lift up all of those who desperately missed their loved ones. For the children and families who are separated from their family members who are caring for the ill and dying. For the children who don't understand. For the parents who feel torn and guilty and tired and inadequate. Lord, we ask for strength and determination and peace as they sacrifice their own well-being to make sure others have the care that they need. Lord, we ask for healing of body, mind, and spirit for those who are in our church and community and world who are suffering. For the cancer patients and other people who need treatment that makes them vulnerable to this virus, please give them protection. Lord, please bless and protect all of the medical personnel, hospital, pharmacy workers, the caregivers at nursing homes, the police, emergency medical workers, all of those who go into harm's way each day to serve others. Watch over those who are maintaining services to keep us fed and with supplies. Give strength to those who are worried about losing their jobs and paying bills. Loving God, for the most vulnerable in our society, for the children and the elders, those who are wholly dependent on others, watch over them carefully. For those in nursing and assisted living homes who cannot be in the presence of their loved ones, provide instead the peace of your constant presence. We ask that you lead those who are searching for answers to end this crisis. Help them be creative and work in harmony with others. And we pray for the leaders of our world board. Give them wisdom and discernment to make good decisions. With grateful hearts, we give you thanks in Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, in glory everlasting. Amen.
Friends, if you would now receive this benediction. The Lord who heals all your iniquity, bless and keep you. The face of the Lord who heals all your afflictions shine upon you and be gracious to you. The light of the countenance of the Lord who redeems your life be lifted upon you and give you peace.